America great again? Baby, you ready to make America great again?
Yes.
Ready to make, that's what this Trail of Fire tour is all about. It's about going to make America great again. You may be wondering why we're cruising down the road with Make America Great t-shirt. Not t-shirts,
no,
but hats. I know what that is. And so the reason is we were pulling in to get diesel right in Ashland City, Tennessee, and we park Blaze, the Trail of Fire tour bus, right next to the Trump train, the Donald Trump, Mike Pence campaign bus, which apparently is still on the road hawking Donald Trump merchandise. And so I figure, what are the odds that there we are, right next Blaze, next to the Trump train? Got a picture with that, and had to get the iconic red hat.
Well, and it's the inaugural edition, because on the side it's got his signature.
Yes.
And the inauguration date, so.
Pretty cool little gas stop. It had like a, I don't know if it was an actual one or just a replica of one, but Barney 5 squad car.
Yeah, you didn't tell me that. I didn't see
it. Was literally as you were pulling in right there at the entrance.
Well, I totally missed it.
Yeah, and then on the inside, a little, you know, mock-up picture-taking spot with Barney and Andy, which I got. And I may have been more enthused about that than the Trump train. I don't know. So, for those of you that are watching the Roadcast by way of video, if this offends you, we also make this available in audio. And so, you can certainly listen to it and not have to visually see. And if you are if you love it, then by all means, feel free to share it. As you know, the rules of the Roadcast are simple. This is our opportunity to kind of bring you on the road with us, kind of give you kind of recounting what's taken place over the last week, some of the testimonies, the things that we've seen on the Trail of Fire tour, as well as just to share the experience. Once the camera is turned on, the microphones roll, it rolls for 30 minutes nonstop, no cuts, no edits, whatever happens on the road, happens on the road. And so are you ready, my friend, to make America great again?
You're so,
so, babe, where are we headed to?
We are currently headed to the other side of Memphis to this Tom Sawyer RV park on our way to Arkansas. So that's kind of like the halfway point.
It is kind of a halfway point from Ashland City, which is right outside of Nashville, on our way to Gasville, Arkansas, where we're going to be at River of Life Church with Josh Passmore, and looking forward to that. That trip just literally got put on the books like a week or two ago.
Yep.
And as I've spoken with Pastor Josh, I'm excited because I believe that what they're doing and what we're doing, it's almost like there's a divine intersection taking place. And so that's going to be really, really fascinating to be able to share with you. And so having just rolled since the last time we did the Roadcast, we just left the ramp and we were on our way to Demopolis, where we were going to be in Demopolis, Alabama, with our good friends Eric and Angela Johnson. Came in there for just a Wednesday night, and something happened during that service that I've never seen happen before. During the middle of the message, there was a whole row of people right in the center of the church.
A little bit towards the back, like the
towards the back, but they were all sitting, you know, all together on one row. Looked like a family, extended family. And as I was ministering, the lady that was on the far end had her arms crossed. There was no feedback whatsoever from her outside of what I was getting was, I don't like you. Not interested in what you've got to say. Just ready for this service to be over with. And yeah, it's kind of like the vibe that you were getting from the whole row, but definitely from right there. And I gave the altar call, and everybody on the row responded by the lifting of their hands. And then whenever I opened up the altar for people to come forward, she was one of the first ones down. And she came and she knelt at the altar, and her husband came at her side. He knelt beside her. And as he was kneeling, he lays his hands on her back. And I came over to pray for her, and I could sense that this was religious. There wasn't a whole lot to it. And then the guy that was sitting next to them, which I thought was a brother, but turns out to be a good friend, he and his wife come over, and they knelt right beside them, and he placed his hands on his friend. And at that moment, I felt all heaven come down.
Yeah.
And I said, there it is. And at that moment, it was like just the Spirit of God moved on all of them at the exact same time, and they literally just began to weep at the altar.
Yeah.
That was the first sign of true brokenness and contrition that I saw. It was like, I and this is what I mean by I saw something I've never seen. I don't think I've ever watched somebody step out of darkness and into light like that.
Mm-hmm. Well,
it wasn't progress. I mean, it was immediate. Was,
yeah. And what was cool is even during the message you had talked about, you're one salvation away from seeing breakthrough is what you mentioned in the message, you know? And so literally seeing that when the altar call was given and the response and then what you just said, how what we witnessed was really powerful. And I can attest from being in the back of the room at that time, I watched the husband and wife talk to each other as they were observing what was happening at the altar. And I watched them both make the decision to say we needed to go up there because they had a discussion about it. I watched it, which I never told you until right now.
Right.
But yeah, I watched that dialogue back and forth, and then they both shook their heads and decided that they both needed to go up there. And when they did, you know, that was when
it was like all heaven
things
came
shifted.
Down.
Yeah.
Things shifted in there. And to come to find out that, you know, they're real key people in the community. They're going to be real key for the church. And so I'm excited about what's going to take place, you know, smaller church. But here's the deal. Revival, you know, like Brownsville, when revival descended upon Brownsville, that was a church of 1,800 people. And, you know, obviously people are like, well, obviously God can use a church like that. More times than not, a lot of the revivals that have shaken nations, they begin in small congregations of people that just make up their mind, they're done with the status quo, and they contend.
Yeah.
And I got high hopes for what Eric and Angela are doing. They're in Demopolis.
Oh, yeah.
We left from Demopolis, and we end up in Hurley, Mississippi, at Full Life Assembly of God. Babe, tell people what you saw.
Wow, Hurley was something else. I'm always amazed, you know, because this is something now that I've been able to be a part of on a weekly basis that I hadn't before as you minister. Because, you know, before you would go and we would stay home for the most part unless it was somewhere local. So being able to see this week after week and experience different houses of worship and just seeing the heart of the pastors connected to the people. And I think that's the biggest thing that I saw there in Hurley was... And I even said it to you the first time I met Pastor Jimbo.
Yeah.
No wonder this church is exploding in growth and the impact in the community, because the moment you meet him, you feel like you've known him for your whole life.
Yep.
He's so personable and so so involved. And so you felt that from the very beginning. And so to see that then transcend to the service and the people's response.
Yes.
It was just phenomenal. And the altar time there was probably one of the most powerful moments I've experienced in altar service.
Yeah, I had something happen at the altar that it wasn't, we haven't seen that before.
Yeah.
You know, I was doing the message on rebuilding the altar. And as I was sharing a story from the book Trail of Fire on the Hebrides, speaking of the burden of prayer, I began distributing rocks, big heavy rocks, to key people that I saw in the sanctuary that I could tell were intercessors or they were key inside the church. And as I laid this in their hands, I was sharing the story. And then I gave one to Pastor Jimbo. And at the end of sharing the story, he and I came to the altar together, the first ones there, to lay that stone there upon the steps of the altar to start rebuilding an altar in the church. What I didn't know was Pastor Jimbo had told me, he said that he had contemplated in the construction of the building of actually building a rock altar.
Really?
In the sanctuary.
Yeah, you didn't tell me that.
And as we laid that on there, he was overwhelmed he said it was almost in one moment as if years worth of repentance and contrition just broke out of him.
Wow.
He said it just was pulled out of him. And then the elders, the leaders gathered around, and those that had other stones came up, and it just swept through the church.
Yeah.
This is a church that has experienced a season of revival in the past, but as Pastor Jimbo has told me, so that now they've been in a lull, but they feel like this year is a year of harvest, and they feel like this is a year of contending. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, we saw the altars flood, and nobody wanted to leave. That service just lasted until, you know, well past one.
Yeah.
Nobody wanted to leave. And then beyond that, that Sunday night was just, you know, again, mind-blowing.
Yeah.
Left from there and headed up to where we've been at this past week with Pastor Chris Moore at Gateway Assembly in Ashland, which is funny to me because we're headed from Ashland and now we're headed to Graceland.
Yeah.
From Ashland to Graceland. Which is key because there was a prophetic word that I shared that the Lord had established the church as a gateway. They're literally situated there right in the backyard of Walmart. So right there in the watering hole.
Yep.
Of the community. Everybody has to come. And they're at the gateway of the city.
Yep.
And I said, your job is to sit at the gate and bestow beauty for ashes.
Yeah.
And it resonated with the church. We saw a powerful Sunday morning. They asked us to do a Sunday night there. And again, just a really marked move of God. Really, really believe great things happening here. And then was invited that next day to come to New Life. Is that right?
I think it was New Life, yeah.
New Life Church, which is pastored by Gerald Pryor. And I think he's been there since the 80s. And what's neat about this church, I mean, it was in the rural woods, hills outside of Ashland City. I mean, I felt like I was going back in time with my grandfather heading through some of the curvy mountain roads that we'd go to as I would take him to like just an old mountain church. And when we get there, these people knew how to pray and they knew how to seek the face of God. Did an interview with one couple that was there. His name was Roy. Roy with, you know, a beard and a little bit of gray, his black beard with a little bit of gray in it. You know, looked like a biker or a trucker, just a really, you know, neat guy. And his wife, Lisa, as I was speaking to them, it was obvious that they've been through something. They have a radical salvation story. They just got saved in 2013, had no church background whatsoever, none, and was invited to come to church. And they came. I mean, they're so clueless about scripture that he called the verses that they were putting up, you know, on the screen or sharing sentences. And in that particular service that they came to, they were doing testimonies, and Roy kind of motions over at his wife, or actually they were living in adultery at the time, says, you should go up there and give your testimony. And she's like, I'm not going up there. She doesn't even know what a testimony is. And so she, next thing she knows, she's getting up out of her seat, walking up to the front.
And this is their first time in church.
First time in church. And she gets up there. She doesn't give a testimony. She starts confessing her sins in front of everybody. And the church, as she's talking about living in adultery and, you know, being suicidal, and she hates, you know, Roy, the guy that she's living with right now. I mean, she's just letting it all spill out. And the pastor takes a stone that had been used earlier in the message and in the service and says, where's it at? And he puts it in her hand and he says this. He says, when Jesus met the adulterous woman, he didn't throw a stone. He says, and we as a church don't either.
Wow.
They got radically saved that morning and have been living for Jesus. They're on fire for Jesus ever since. And that really is, you know, a lot of what that church is made up of.
Yeah.
Just really neat people. And so I probably walked out of that church last night having received more than I imparted, and just loved it. Absolutely loved it. And so what do you thought so far? We're about a month and a half in.
Well, I mean, I'm loving it. I'm loving that that we get to do this together. I mean, yeah. I know I probably say that a lot.
We did Valentine's Day together on the road.
We did. We had a great day.
Yes.
The whole family spent it together.
I got you your favorite tulips.
Yes, you did.
Yes. Making my family great again. Not that it's never not been great.
No, but it's cool because, you know, the kids, you know, it can be difficult for kids to be in a different place every single week,
yes.
You know, transitioning.
They're
know.
Loving it.
But they do. They do very well, and they're meeting new friends, which is fantastic. They're involved in the services. I mean, truly, our kids were involved this last Sunday in service because,
yeah.
Oh, wow, that was
Chase,
a lot of fun.
Chase got broken free in the wrong kind of way. And Sunday morning, I'm ministering. Actually, Sunday night, I think
Sunday
I'm ministering.
Yeah.
And I'm ministering to people there in the altar, and all of a sudden, Chase just comes running through the altar laughing and giggling. As he's being chased by his brother who's trying to, you know, catch him. And then he comes running back through and mom's running after him trying to catch them. And so
it was quite the ordeal.
Yes.
But somebody came up to me, and this was neat, because that night you talked about the Azusa Street.
Yes.
And how you shared that part of that story, that the glory cloud was so evident and so thick at times that the kids would often play hide and seek.
Yeah, in the cloud.
In the cloud. And so someone came up to me, it was the worship leader, I believe, Jonathan, he came up, he says, you know what? I thought it was neat that they came up, you know, because Daniel was sharing that story about how the kids would just play in the glory cloud. And you know, it's not a traditional thing. It's not that we let our kids run around and be disruptive or whatever, but he
right.
said, you know, don't worry about it.
Right.
They were just being kids.
Yep.
And you know, and I think that's a big thing for me to remember.
And as we said, it's life on the road. So
okay, just a minute. You know, and just letting them be kids.
Yeah.
You know, and so yeah, they get into trouble and they're mischievous, but they're kids. They're having fun. They're living life. They're making memories. And
yes.
And I love that. Love that. We are involving them in the services. They're in the presence of the Lord. We're all together.
To me,
we're making
that's key.
Memories. Yeah.
I refuse to watch my kids grow up and not know what it is to be in the moving of the Spirit.
Yeah.
That's what I want them to see.
Yeah.
That's how you make your family great again. You put them in the presence of the Lord.
That's right. Because it changes it changes their perspective.
The presence changes everything.
It changes everything, you know.
Now, one thing that we want to shift gears here a little bit and talk about how we're doing what we're doing. Some people have been curious about it. One thing that's really neat, we haven't discussed it yet, but we are living
debt free.
Come on, baby.
Woo! Yes.
Debt free, baby!
Awesome.
We're debt free. You know, I mean, some people literally, that's what their dream is they're, you know, they're working hard, they're trying to pay off the bills, you know, so that they can live debt-free. And some people have wondered, you know, how are you guys financing? How are you doing what you're doing? How do you make this work? You know, because I had one lady the other day at getting my hair cut, and she's hearing what we're doing, and she's like, you're living my dream. And I said, you know, she's waiting to retire so that she's debt-free. She's on the Dave Ramsey plan. Good for her, you know, and she wants to one day to travel America. And she's like, I said, you know, why do you have to wait? You know, this is what we did. All right. So I'm going to talk to you about living debt-free as Jenna vanishes for the next few moments to go help Chase use the potty.
This is the advantage of having a potty.
On the road.
On the road.
Are you taking off your microphone? Yes, she is. Look at
yes.
Look at her. She's taking off
That's
her microphone.
Kingdom.
Can I have the notes for
yeah.
the...
We're at 19.
Okay, all right, 19 minutes.
Yep.
Like we said, whatever happens on the road.
Real
and
life, guys.
It's real life. So, neat thing is we don't have to pull over for a pit stop.
I'm coming. Yes, I'm coming.
So, last year when we sold our home, we sold our home, sold all of our furniture, sold vehicles. Yeah, we sold everything that wasn't replaceable. And with those finances, we paid off all of our debt. You know, at that point in time with the mortgage, the vehicles, I mean, we're well over $200,000 in debt. And, you know, we're fortunate enough to have walked away with some equity in the house to be able to pay off all of our debt, to purchase the motor coach and the Ford Explorer that we're using to travel around with in cash. And make all the modifications and things that we needed to the coach, and to be able to pay for all of that stuff in cash. So we began the year at zero. We began the year with no debt, and I can't tell you what an incredible burden that is that's lifted, knowing that you're totally free, and it makes us free to be able to go place to place. I think about what Jesus said, you know, birds have a nest, foxes have holes, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. Well, we do have a place to lay our head, but he lived free, and we're living free, and we're able to do this tour and not be a burden. You know, we don't charge churches. We don't ask for a certain thing when we come into the house. We do everything by love offering, and we don't even ask for lodging. We don't ask for gas. We don't ask for meals. We don't ask for anything, period. We just come to partner alongside the churches as we're all contending and believing for revival and awakening. And so one thing that I did is kind of broke down the first month's expenses. I know that some people may not find this fascinating. Some people would be curious, you know, so how are you living life on the road and making this thing happen? And yes, I'm driving down the road and I'm now looking at Jenna's phone, but I can do this, I promise, and be safe. And don't you fuss at me. So kind of our January expenses. In total, we spent just a little over $2,000 in housing cost. And what I mean by that is everything that it would cost us to live. You know, the RV parks, gas, and I'll give you the breakdown here in just a second. And I think that we can actually get that down. I think we spent probably $1,000 too much. And so we could have spent $1,000 this last month total on housing cost, and with that be able to save, which is the other part of what we're doing. And I'll talk about that in just a moment. But our January expenses, we spent $370.80 at RV parks. And that predominantly was Stone Mountain, Georgia. We spent over a week and a half with the RV parked there in Stone Mountain. Incredible park, you know, so it's about a week and a half, $370.80. I mean, $370.80. And that's more of one of the more expensive parks that you could stay in, but great, great, great park. Another thing that we spent money on in January was upgrades to the RV, $526.12. One of those was incredibly necessary, and that was a new mattress for the boys for the sofa sleeper. The mattress that was there had springs coming out of it and holes and rips. It just was not comfortable. And so we went to mattressinsider.com and ordered a really nice memory foam mattress that the boys are sleeping on, and it is comfortable. I wouldn't mind. In fact, I've slept on it one night as one of the boys was sick. And then the other thing that we spent the lion's share of that money on was adding an Apple TV to the back bedroom. And so for entertainment, we don't have a satellite. We have an antenna, which picks up local stations. And then we have two Apple TVs with like a subscription to Netflix. And we're using a DirecTV subscription as well that allows the kids to be able to watch. I laughed at it. There's a reason that I laughed at that, and I won't tell why right now. Don't want it captured on audio. Anyway, that allows the kids to watch Disney Channel and other things whenever we've got a good Wi-Fi signal. When we don't, obviously we're down to just the antenna. And when that's not working, we've got DVDs. And so, also, let's see, we spent $677.96 on maintenance. Two big purchases with that. One was a macerator pump. And let's see, how do I explain the macerator? It is a food processor that you hook up to the black tank. The black tank is when you pull the hinge on the toilet and the toilet flushes, it all goes into the black tank, and the macerator pump connects to the end of that. And it's like a food processor. It allows what's inside the tank to be blended up and pushed out through a garden hose, and it can be disposed of in something as simple as a toilet. So it's real helpful whenever we're at a church that does not have dump stations or a way to be able to eliminate the sewage. We can do that simply inside of a toilet. And so that was a necessary purchase. And then another, what, $228 for replacing the toilet itself when we were at Stone Mountain. I think I mentioned this on the last one, that the toilet broke. And the toilet was left wide open whenever it broke, which meant that everything that was in the black tank, yeah, it was smellable throughout the rest of the coach. And so that was certainly something that needed to be replaced. And now it has functioned now for the last, what, 3 weeks, and it's done great. We've spent $192.66 in propane. We've got a 100-gallon propane tank that is attached to the chassis of the coach. That's what we use for heating. That's what we use for cooking. And that's what we used for the hot water. I just fixed our hot water heater. Getting to be quite handy. The hot water heater for showers, the electric side of it, because it's both gas and electric, the electric side was not functioning, so we were using the propane exclusively to be able to heat up our water. Now that I've got that fixed, and now that we're moving into warmer weather, I imagine that cost is going to drop tremendously. And then on top of that, another $100 for insurance on the coach, and then diesel for the coach, $209.52 for the month. Didn't do a lot of mileage. A lot of the places that we went to was about 3 hours apart from each other, and so we spent $209.52 in gas. And so grand total, $2,081.01 on housing expenses. And to kind of put that in perspective, last year, with our housing cost in Dallas, we were averaging, by the time that you figure taxes, insurance, homeowners association fees, utilities, we were averaging about $3,000 a month. So already, just in January, that means that we saved $1,000. And part of our goal is to be able to make our house payment to ourselves this year. So not only are we debt-free, we're also making our house payment to ourselves and trying to double that. And so grand total net for saving for this last month, it looks like we might have been able to put aside $1,500 to $2,000 away in the savings account. So come on, somebody. So that's pretty neat. So anyway, if you got any questions on any of that, by all means, drop us a note in our comment section below or on the video that you see here. I'll try and also post those numbers, as well as pictures of Blaze with the Trump train, which I think is kind of neat because, hello, making America great again. That's it. So let me leave you with this in the last 3 minutes that we have together here in the road blog. And looks like Jenna will not be getting back to us in time. Sunday morning, I stepped into Gateway about an hour early to go pray. It's one thing that I love to do is to go into the sanctuary and just kneel at the altar and pray. And as I was kneeling there and just listening, the Lord spoke to me and he said, so many of my people today are asking for rain. They're asking for a season of outpouring. He says, but all along, I've been patiently waiting at a well. I began to weep as I thought that about that. Because part of what we're contending for this year is to see an outpouring. We want to see revival come to our nation, and we often tend to think of that as, you know, the heavens opening and the rain descending. Well, the heavens opened on the day of Pentecost, and not once has he ever shut them. If there's not rain pouring down in your life, my friend, it's not because the Lord is withholding the rain. It's because we have chosen to withhold it from ourselves. We've shut ourselves off from the flow of heaven. The Lord said, my people are asking for rain, but all along I have been patiently waiting at a well. A well is not contingent upon seasons. A well is not contingent upon the atmosphere. A well is not contingent upon the environment. A well simply produces water. And isn't that what Jesus said? He said, all those who are thirsty, all those who are hungry, come to me and I will give a drink. To the woman at the well that he was waiting for as she came that day, he said, if you knew who I was, you would have asked of me and I would have given you living water, and it would have become a spring of life within you. My friend, I am convinced that we do not have to live outside of an outpouring. We don't have to live with this mistaken idea that revival and awakening is something that's so far beyond us. Jesus is literally waiting on you at a well. Just waiting for you to take the time to stop what you're doing. Come back to an altar, and there upon your knees, let him begin to fill you with life everlasting. Jenna is back, which is perfect because we are down to the last few seconds of the roadcast. How was your trip to the restroom with the boy?
Oh, it's always a fun experience. I don't think that anybody really wants to hear about that.
Oh, we just had a discussion while you were not on the roadcast.
Oh, that's beautiful.
Oh, yes, we were discussing things.
And yeah, so, okay.
Anyway, on our way from Ashland to Graceland, going to take Jenna to go see Rhea. Rhea really loves Elvis. We haven't figured this one out.
Which is okay. I mean, Elvis is cool.
Elvis is cool.
You know.
Maybe your generation didn't think so. Your parents' generation thought that he might have been a little risque, but now the way the world is today, I think most people are like, he's pretty tame.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, Rhea really wants to go to Graceland. So tomorrow I'm going to take her to Graceland, and we'll video that. Rhea will have it up on her road blog, which will be fun. She's got a lot of road blogs that need to come out. I mean, she has been to the USS Alabama. She has been to the Parthenon and
Stone Mountain.
She's been to Stone Mountain. All of those are videos that have not posted yet. And then she's going to have Graceland. So there's four that you can be looking for just from Rhea and the kids that's coming up. I promise this week we'll make it all happen.
Yeah.
So anyway, my friend, we love you. We love you. We love you. Thank you for letting us be a part of your life. And thanks for listening in on the roadcast. Jenna, you want to say anything?
I'm good.
She's good. Well, there you go. Make, come on, say it. Say it with me.
Make America great again.
Love you guys. And we will see you next time on the Roadcast.